Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Virtual Dance Studies Colloquium, coming to you, technically speaking, from Temple University in Philadelphia as part of the Institute of Dance Scholarship in the Boyer College of Music and Dance. I'm Mark Franco. I'm directing the Institute right now and running the virtual colloquium, and this is the third in our series of talks, all celebrating recently published books. So in a moment, I'll introduce Carrie Noland, our speaker for today, who will be talking about material relative to her new book, Merce Cunningham, After the Arbitrary. And I have my copy right here, as you see. I just wanted to say that please, if you have comments, put them in the Q&A box. Or if you can, avoid the chat, because I'll be looking mostly at the Q&A box at the end, and we will address your questions and comments that way. We don't have any way to have our audience literally speak up, but please do write, and we will take up your questions at the end of the talk. So, it's my pleasure to introduce today my colleague, Carrie Noland, who is professor of French and comparative literature and director of the International Center for Writing and Translation at the University of California, Irvine. She's the author of four books: Poetry at Stake, Lyric Aesthetics, and the Challenge of Technology, Princeton, 1999, Agency and Embodiment, Harvard, 2009, Voices of Negritude in Modernist Print, Columbia, 2015, and the book I just mentioned, her new book, Merce Cunningham, After the Arbitrary, at Chicago University Press. In collaboration with Sally Ann Ness, she co-edited Migrations of Gesture, Minnesota, 2008, and with the poet Barrett Watton, she co-edited Diasporic Avant-Garde, Palgrave, 2009. Noland studies the interplay between technology and artistic creation from a variety of angles, moving from performance, poetry, to dance, from subjectivation to racialization. She is the recipient of fellowships from the National Endowment of the Humanities, the American Philosophical Society, the Camargo Foundation, the American Council of Learned Societies, the Clark Oakley Humanities Center, and the John Simon Guggenheim Foundation. She has a current project focusing on Husserl and the question of presence in performance and political contexts. But today she's going to speak to us about the archive, the Merce Cunningham Archive in particular, and issues of belonging. Welcome, Carrie.
Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you for having me. I'm distressed that we're not in person because you give the best campus visits, so the best invited lecturer visits. I remember many wonderful meals with you and with Cheryl Dodds and others of your colleagues. So one day we'll do this again in person. Anyway, hello everyone. I want to apologize first for not having a lot of audiovisual stuff until the end of my talk. There will be some at the beginning and then a lot more at the end. There'll be stuff to look at, but mostly at the end. And I have to do a lot of juggling between different platforms. So if I mess up at some point, please be patient with me. I've got a lot to show you. Okay. When I first gave Mark my title for this talk, I really didn't know what I meant by belonging or the temporality of belonging. These are both in my title, but I've had a few months to mull it over, and I found that the term belonging especially resonates more and more with a whole host of questions that have to do not only with my experience in the archive, but also with the archival reflections going on today in a variety of realms, including Black studies and postcolonial studies. There are many ways to advance with the notion of belonging. There's what belongs in the archive. There's who belongs in the archive. That is, who gets to have an archive, but also who gets to go into the archive, who belongs there. authorized by the Merce Cunningham Trust, I was able to belong to the Merce Cunningham Dance Company's archive for a while. That meant I had to spend many hours in the Jerome Robbins collection at the Performing Arts Library at Lincoln Center, part of the New York Public Library system. But Cunningham's archive was not always housed at the NYPL. And now I'm going to share my screen and begin my PowerPoint presentation. There we go. And I have to make it large. Okay. So here we have the artist housing, and this is the studio. And the archive actually began as a modest collection of programs, studio shots, reviews, notes, 16 millimeter reels, videotapes, and other ephemera related to Merce Cunningham and his company, distributed on shelves and in filing cabinets in a one bedroom apartment on the second floor of the Westbeth Artist Housing in Greenwich Village. Up until their transfer to Lincoln Center circa 2014, the items in the archive were lovingly preserved by David Vaughn, deceased in 2017, who became the company's secretary way back in 1959. He began the whole archive by collecting the programs that Cunningham would bring back when he returned from a tour. Finally, in 1976, the Cunningham Dance Foundation received an NEA grant to hire Vaughn as the official archivist. To this day, there is a kind of makeshift quality to the archive. Many of the concert reviews are not dated, and there's no attempt to account for the types of supports Cunningham used for his notes, the back of old programs, posters, class schedules, and Cage's endless sheets of computer-generated hexagrams. These makeshift supports are telling, rich with information on Cunningham's financial resources, his recycling ethos, and the ancillary events taking place at that moment in his life and in history. Sometimes Cunningham scribbled in the margins of choreographic notes questions he was privately asking himself. During the composition of Canfield, for instance, 1969, he wonders, where do dance steps or dance movements come from? And he underlines this twice. In September of 1980, while choreographing Channel's inserts, he is inspired by the geometry of a shot of a road he saw in a Godard film, Sauve qui peut. Marginal jottings show that he is acutely attentive to the changes in perception caused by TV channel surfing, discoveries in physics, and unexpected challenges from the Judson Church dancers for his title as premier avant-garde radical. A moving entry in a notebook used while composing Loose Time of 2001, well, the dance was actually premiered in 2002, but he wrote this note in 2001, and that's important. These notes record his thoughts as he sat at the Heathrow Airport. Quote, "The shock in the Heathrow lounge is enormous as the waiting passengers began to hear more details of the hit buildings and the enormity of the attack." The note is dated 10/11/2001, but it appears to be recounting in a mixture of past and present tenses his transit from London to Milan on 9/11. Some of the paratexts are more mundane in nature, and others more technical. While working on Ocean in 1993, he reflects on the role of advances in computer technology and how they have impacted his choreography. And this is Cedric Andrieux and Andrea Weber. In a more humorous vein, we find a marginal note that he nicknamed a phrase from Double Toss of 1993, "fucking in the bushes." And I'm sorry, I don't have a slide of that. The notes for Antic Meat of 1958 contain his budget for the month, $1.80 for costumes, $1.25 for phone bill, $37.50 for rent, and so on. The folders are peppered with carbon copies of letters requesting financial aid from fellow artists, including one as late as 1993 to Yoko Ono. There are many other documents underscoring the obsessive account-keeping Cunningham felt he had to engage in, even while in the midst of observing a rehearsal or working out the floor plan of a quartet. This phenomenon was very moving to me, and I've written about it elsewhere, his early poverty. So too was the substance of a note to himself that I found on the back of a page of choreographic drawings for Enter of 1992, written in French. Ma vie maintenant. J'ai âgé, mais j'ai l'idée de continuer dans la danse, de faire des nouvelles danses. Avec quelles idées? With what ideas? He's asking himself, what ideas do I still have? And he underscores this three times. As I handled these materials, I wondered, do these lists, questions, budgets belong to the archive? If so, how do they belong? Are these contingencies part of the dance and therefore part of the way we might, from archival documents, reenact the dance? And here, while I continue talking, I'm just going to show you a kind of typical piece of material that I found anyone would find in the archive. This is the floor plan for Summer Space of 1958, and it's on the back of a poster for a play ostensibly he went to called Testimonio. In a wonderful meditative piece titled The Taste of the Archive, Brent Hayes Edwards writes about poignant finds, those bits of the archive that give us a stronger, quote, sense of encountering the past. And he goes on, finding something in an archive poignant in this way does not necessarily mean there is anything to say about it. Coming home from the archive, as Arlette Farge notes, is often vexing, as the physical pleasure of the rediscovered trace is followed by the doubt mixed with impotence caused by not knowing what to do with it. Edwards then goes on to cite Adorno's musings in Minima Moralia on the muteness of the worthless shard that pierces you, a shard that might not be so worthless after all, I would suggest. This shard can open up an alternative history or history itself. In Brent's case, what pierced him as he forged through Claude McKay's archive was a photograph. And this is so often the case, as it was for Mark when he was exposed to a photograph of Serge Liffard, composed and engaged amidst the uniformed Nazis, as he writes in the fascist turn in The Dance of Serge Liffard. Just there, as there is a punctum of the photograph to evoke Bart, so too, I believe, there's a punctum of the archive. Once we have entered an artist's archival world, we are pricked by a singular telling element of the audiovisual array. We are drawn by it into the story it alone might tell. Part two, and there are four parts, just so you have a sense of where we are in my talk. The archive and the anarchive. There is no doubt that the archive of the Merce Cunningham Dance Company is very rich, very full. And while the archival apparatus was undeveloped when Vaughan began, over time the collection has benefited from the most sophisticated methods and technologies capable of classifying and digitalizing its contents. From 1979 on, I don't think there was ever any question that Cunningham deserved the time and expense of an archive, that he belonged. So it would not make sense to compare the archival project in his case to those launched to retrieve information on wayward lives, to use Saidiya Hartman's lyrical expression, or to resurrect alternative colonial histories, as in Leah Brosgal's Absent the Archive, Cultural Traces of a Massacre in Paris, 17 October, 1961. Nor can we compare my own research mission to those undertaken by scholars in dance trying to discover or compile archives on minority or queer dancers whose works have not benefited from the same degree of support or attention as Cunningham's. But this does not mean that there are not places of silence in the Cunningham archive, subjects and connections hinted at but left dangling like loose or buried threads. In the course of my research, I identified several such threads that I chose not to pursue or couldn't figure out how to pursue, such as his private life, his sexual orientation, his politics, and his relationship to his very few minority dancers. I'll get back to that later. Archival research in general is rhizomatic, but in the case of the performance arts, it may be even more difficult to contain because of the powerful will to revive, reconstruct, or reenact. For this reason, the distinction many scholars have made between the archive and the anarchive seems to me at once untenable and necessary. If the archival impulse gathers, classifies, and hierarchizes, the anarchival impulse disperses, networks, and upends. Andrew Murphy says it well in Not Quite an Anarchive. The researcher attempts to, quote, edge with care towards the anarchival within the archive. Against the ordering, totalizing, and containing structures of the archived collection, the anarchivist presses beyond, quote, edging with care toward objects or utterances yet to be archived. It is important to ask, though, whether what one finds beyond the archive, in popular culture, for instance, in the case of Broskow's work, or in the speculative, fabulating imagination in Hartman's, actually belongs to the archive or in the archive, or belongs in the same archive. Is the archive limitlessly absorptive? What does it mean to edge with care towards its border? What aesthetic theory, what theory of the artwork solicits this care? I've described some of my more poignant finds, my shards, but now I want to turn to the discovery in the archive that actually did end up directing my research for the book. In my case, a photograph was not at the origin, but rather a note about a photograph, or more accurately, a set of photographs. Arriving in New York in the fall of 2015, I began a systematic chronological combing through of the folders devoted to each dance in Cunningham's 70 years of repertory. In the folder covering the genesis of Suite for Five, which was begun with Solo Suite in 1952 and ended in, he composed it over 6 years in 1958, I came across an intriguing bit of paper. So you'll see at the top, it says duet, second movement of Sokat, which became second hand in 1970. He never used this set of notes for second hand. This set of notes actually was used and refers to the duet and Suite for Five. And you'll see a list of the elements that he wants to use. The only part he used in the Sokat was to walk into a run around the stage. That's how secondhand begins, which is what Sokat became. But you'll see he writes from Lewis's photos at the top, and then he has a bunch of little figure drawings. I was determined to identify who Lewis was, Lewis's photos, and to understand better what his photos had to do with the completion of this duet that eventually took on the title Extended Moment, a very significant title, actually. At first, I thought Lewis referred to Lewis Horst, who had taught Cunningham dance composition at the Bennington Summer Session. But I was lucky enough to snag an interview, one of her last, with Carolyn Brown in the summer of 2014. In a follow-up phone call, I asked her who Lewis was, and she replied immediately, "Oh, Lewis Stevenson." There were even passages in her book, Chance and Circumstance, that refer specifically to Stevenson and to the fact that, as a friend, he would sometimes sit in on rehearsals and take pictures of the company in Merce's studio. Once I had Lewis's full name, I was able to search the photographic archive in the Jerome Robbins collection and identify a folder full of his photos. And wouldn't you know, several of these photos were of Carolyn Brown and Merce Cunningham posing in precisely the arrangements we find scribbled on this piece of paper. Most of the photographs in the folder were studio shots of poses from Spring Weather and People of 1955. I figured out that Cunningham had intended to use these photographic documents of his own past dances as an archive to plumb for the new duet. And he wasn't just imitating the positions, sometimes verbatim and sometimes less so. He was attempting to capture the temporality of the photograph, the singular quality of photographic arrest. And here, just to give you an example, number one, Carol on floor, M. arabesque over her. This is the photograph that he was referring to and that he wanted to recycle in a later duet. Okay. I'm going to show you in a moment a short clip of Suite 4-5 so that you get a sense of what it looked like. Maybe I'll do that now. I'm not going to go further into the argument I made about it, but you can read that in chapter 4, but I'm just going to show you the clip of what this looked like. I have to stop sharing for a moment. Excuse me while I do this. I need to change my screen. And I need to draw up this. So hold on while I futz around with it. Okay. So I'm going to share my screen again. Here we go. And here's just part of Suite 4-5 where you see the photographs reenacted. Oops, it seems to have disappeared on my screen. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to go back to it.
It's good. Can you see it? Yeah.
You guys can see it? Okay, great.
Well, it seems to have stopped now.
You can't see it anymore?
Yeah, but it stopped. It's not moving.
Huh. Okay, I'm going to stop and start it. Is it moving now? Can you see it now?
See it, but it's not moving. No,
it's good. Can you see it now?
All good.
This is archival footage from Hamburg, so that's a TV station. Okay, that's enough. I will go back. I just need to set up the PowerPoint again. Okay. All right. So here I want to draw your attention to two conceptual moves that Cunningham made during this period that would define the quality and the technique of his dancing. So first, photographic stillness. When I suggested to Carolyn that the photographs she had helped me to identify served as poses to be integrated into the danced material of Extended Moment, she became quite testy. Merce did not use poses in his dances, she insisted. Position is more accurate. She didn't like the word pose because of its association with fashion and the display connotations of the balletic pose plastique. However, I found that Cunningham used the word pose in his own notes continuously from Septet of 1953 all the way through Ocean of 1994. Nevertheless, Marion Prager Simon, whom I interviewed later that same year, also advised me to avoid the word pose. Merce's stillness, she said, is not the stillness of held poses. Still, but not held. I do understand and respect the difference, and I know why it was important to those who traveled in Merce's circle of the 1950s and 60s. For Carolyn, Merce, for Carolyn and Marianne, Merce was aiming to achieve a vibrant electricity in her words. But I don't think this is all there is to it. This stillness is not about the exhibition of, quote, the body's gestural potential, to evoke Lucia Ruprecht's argument concerning the vibratory. It is not an instant, and I'm not even sure it's gestural, but it is intervallic. For Cunningham, the stillness exemplified by the performed photograph reflects a measurement of counted time. 3 seconds, for instance, which is approximately how long the dancers hold each pose in the clip I've shown you. Stillness is a duration of time passing, not time standing still. It is simply the body's belonging to time. Time understood here as the chronological tick-tock succession of moments. Cunningham's choreographic technique here manifests a quantitative approach to choreographed movement. And now we come to the second innovation he made at precisely this moment, that is while composing Suite for Five. And that is the imperfections on paper approach, first tested out in 1953 as solo suite in Space and Time. And here we have the imperfections on paper that are numbered. He recopied them onto this sheet. And each of these little bars represents 5 seconds. So these are 30 second intervals here. And you see the numbers, 1, 2 is some is there, 3, 4, 5, etc. Okay. Cunningham numbered the imperfections on a sheet of paper, each of which represents another spot on a rectangular stage. Each line on the sheet indicates a 5 second interval, as I've just explained. And if you look at this, you see that from 2 to 5, the dancer has 30 seconds to complete the predetermined sequence of steps. As is well known, Cunningham rarely indicated dynamics or qualities of movement. He just assigned an amount of time it would take to get from one numbered spot to another. This was an important element of his signature technique. It ended up determining the peculiar way his dances look. The time it took for that dancer to execute an assigned number of movements in a given time frame dictated the rhythm, the phrasing, and the dynamics. So, as Carolyn reminded me, the timings themselves had qualitative implications, durations, not emotions, impose affects. Time passing produces human being. Part 3, oral history. I mention this anecdote not only to clarify his process, but also to demonstrate the crucial importance of oral accounts. My argument concerning the role of photographic time in Cunningham's technique grew out of a conversation, an oral exchange held outside of the archive, although with someone who is very much of it, a conversation about Cunningham's growing fascination with recording technologies. And so now I wanted to turn briefly to the issue of oral histories in dance scholarship, their place and their time of belonging in the dance archive. Some of you probably know about or have encountered the New York Public Library's Dance Oral History Project, begun in 1974 under the tutelage of the first dance curator, Genevieve Oswald, who officially founded the dance collection in 1947. She also co-founded CORD, Congress on Dance Research, in 1965. I was able to listen to over a dozen audio taped interviews conducted under the umbrella of the Dance Oral History Project with dancers associated with Cunningham. Just to give you a sense of the collection and its temporal range, I won't read all the names, but just to give you a sense of it, beginning in 1977, David Vaughan interviews Bonnie Bird, who was Cunningham's first modern dance teacher, a Graham dancer. And there's interviews with Dorothea Beria, Bela Farber, Jean Erdman, Robert Swinson, Carolyn Brown, of course, Marilyn Wood, Douglas Dunn, Carol Armitage, Valder Setterfield, and in 2014, Gus Solomons Jr. Let us note that there is no oral history provided by Sevilla Fort, even though she, like Byrd, Erdman, and Beria, knew Cunningham during that crucial early phase of his career. And this is shot of Bonnie Byrd with Cunningham and Sevilla Fort and her other dancers from the Cornish School when they toured in the summer of 1938. Fort was the only African-American student at the Cornish School. Her mother was a housekeeper for Nellie Cornish, and she toured with Merce and the others and was the inspiration for John Cage's invention of the prepared piano, which he concocted in order to provide what she requested should be Africanist music for her senior recital piece in 1940, Bacchanal. So we don't have an oral history from her, but neither do we find in the oral history archive an interview with Ulysses Dove, a Black dancer who was a member of Cunningham's company from 1970 to 1973, nor with Michael Cole, who was in the company from 1989 to 1998, nor with Roshan Mitchell, who was in the company from 2004 to 2011, all dancers who identify as Black, nor do we have Gus Solomon until 2014. He danced with the company from 1965 to 1968 and originated the role of in Winterbranch. He was interviewed by Vaughn for Ballet Review in 1987 and by Sally Baines, Brenda Dixon Gottschild, and Nancy Delva between 2000 and 2010. Judging by his enthusiasm and affection for Merce, I'm sure he would have been happy to accord an official oral history interview earlier on. But it took until 2014 for the NYPL Dance Oral History Project to catch up with Solomon's. And only very, very recently have questions begun to be asked that target specifically the experiences of Black Cunningham dancers and their relative absence from archival attention. As far as I know, it wasn't until July of 2020 that Solomons was invited to speak during an audio interview about what it was like to be the sole Black member of the Merce Cunningham Dance Company. I'd like to play you a part of that interview now. It is found on Spotify in a series called Dance and Stuff that some of you may know of, moderated by Reed Bartown and Jack Ferver. I'll be playing you a clip from episode number 160, recorded on July 10, 2020. In a unique coup, the interviewers were able to bring together three Black Cunningham dancers, Gus Solomons Jr., Michael Cole, and Roshan Mitchell. And let me situate the part of the interview I'm going to be playing for you just so that you understand what's going on. The three dancers have been talking about their respective experiences as the only Black dancers in the company at any given time. Gus Solomon talks about his background, why he, unlike other young aspiring Black performers, had access to Cunningham's downtown aesthetic, as opposed to the uptown aesthetic, which was more ballet or Broadway. Solomons grew up in a white neighborhood, felt comfortable in white social situations, and was exposed to avant-garde aesthetics early on. Then all three agreed that Cunningham technique was vital for their development. They needed physical challenges and not platforms for emotional expression. And the three of them actually talk a good deal about how they didn't like Alvin Ailey. They talk about how hard they try to get their young students now to appreciate the freedom that learning Cunningham technique can bring them against the resistance of the students who aren't interested in a white, seemingly abstract and apolitical aesthetic. But then, just before the part I'm gonna have you listen to, Michael Cole discusses his disappointment when another Black dancer, Mark Mann, was not taken into the company. Michael Cole, had asked to mentor Mark and wanted very much to be on stage with him, but Mark was not retained. Okay, so I'm gonna play you the end of the clip when the three of them are discussing Night of 100 Solos. And I'll be showing you a clip of that dance as well, which was performed in 2020. I hope this works. It's from my phone and I apologize for the bad sound.
You know, so I was talking about one man and how, you know, he was let go. And I realized, you know, in that moment in time that, yeah, I'm really lonely in this company for another person of color. I for each work. And then, of course, you know, I moved past it because, you know, the work is so many. That's what you focused on. But I think the other thing too, you know, Rashawn was sort of alluding to this, you know, due to access and whatever, like, you know, I felt the recognition from the downtown Black dancers, but never from the uptown ones while I was dancing the company. That also was really painful for me when I realized that. But, you know, we've spoken a lot today about the Night of 100 Solos. And I will say, in that moment, I saw both the dress rehearsal and the actual performance at BAM, and really it was the moment. You know, when you're watching it, you know, it's solos, and like, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, the most people on stage, and yeah, you'd see a Black body. For me, when I first saw it, I'm like, oh yeah, that's Jennifer Weaver's solo, and blah, 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 oh, Trish Mack did that, oh, Alan Good did that. Like, you know, I'm playing, a game of name that dance. Until 4:33, which for those in the audience who don't know, 4:33 is the dance that was choreographed. It's the response to John Cage's his musical and life partner's most famous musical composition, which is 4 minutes and 33 seconds of silence broken down into 3 movements of silence. So Murph made a dance, 4 minutes and 33 seconds of stillness broken down into 3 movements of stillness, meaning like hit one position for, let's say, 1 minute and 12 seconds, and then another, you know, and it rounds out to 4:33. That's the dance. But, you know, the Night of 100 Solos, the entire company save one dancer all perform 4:33. So then you're like, wait a minute, you're all in stillness. And I don't know what the number is. I want to see 10 Black dancers who are on that stage. And I'm sorry, like, I'm really emotional, but it was that moment of that, like, oh my God, I'm having my Mark Mann moment of that. I didn't really see myself for the first time in this work that I just love so much that I felt like I could never really share it beyond what I shared with you guys and Rashawn and Ulysses. And I think it was the greatest gift of my life was to witness that.
Okay. Were you able to hear that?
It's a little ringing sound around it. So I didn't make out absolutely every detail. If you could just review it quickly.
Sure. Okay. So I'm sorry about the quality of the sound. You can find it online, dance and stuff. But Michael Cole is saying that it was very moving for him when he saw the performance, the New York performance of 100 Solos in April of 2020, because for the very first time he saw himself on stage. He saw more than one Black dancer on the stage, and that loneliness that he felt, he was able to acknowledge that and feel very grateful for the fact that the stagers had gone beyond his own experience, beyond that loneliness. I'm paraphrasing as best I can. What I find moving about this exchange is the ambivalence these dancers express with respect to their time in the company. that ambivalence does not lead them either to stifle their discomfort or to cancel Cunningham because of it. Cunningham doesn't have to be their hero for them to respect and cherish what he gave them. The truth is that there are plenty of sexist and racist comments scattered throughout the Cage Cunningham record. Neither we nor these dancers can ignore this. For most of his life, when teaching or rehearsing, Cunningham called men men and women girls. For whatever reason, it is an undeniable fact that he did not choose Black women to be in his company. But what these dancers show is that they can harbor their ambivalence, recalling those unpleasant aspects of Cunningham's career, even as they admire the artistry and mystery of his creations. To do both at once, I want to suggest, is to cultivate a dialectical understanding of how art and history co-evolve. So part four, concluding. I want to end by juxtaposing two opposed approaches to what constitutes a dance archive. The first approach is represented by Carolyn Brown. Carolyn has become infamous for claiming that what passes for a Cunningham dance today, as it is performed now, is not a Cunningham dance. In her 2014 interview with me, she confided, quote, "It makes me very nervous when these dances get restaged. The rhythms change." From her perspective, only the dancers who were taught the roles by Merce, whose bodies under his discerning eye imprinted the choreography with their timing, can lay claim to dancing a Cunningham dance. "When it's over," she insisted. "The archive is closed, done, period." In contrast, there is Laura Kuhn's approach. "John and Merce," she said, Laura Kuhn is the archivist for John Cage. "John and Merce," she says, "left a toolbox. It is meant to be reopened, its contents reshuffled, reused." This is more or less the perspective that has governed decisions taken by the Trust and the former Cunningham dancers who staged the Night of 100 Solos. One of the most striking things about 100 Solos was the stunning diversity of the dancers, a rainbow of dancers in Gus Solomon's words. But equally striking was the disconcerting gap between what the dance looked like in the 1950s or any other period before the dissolution of the company in 2011, and what that dance looked like as performed in 100 Solos. According to the three stagers and many of the reviewers as well, this gap should not be a cause for lamentation, but rather celebration. From this second revisionist perspective, the archive is in the future. It is happening in an endless now. Okay, now I'm going to say something polemical. There's a persuasive political and rationale and a theoretical force compelling me to agree heartily with the latter approach, in which we celebrate the, quote, "continually renewed, unfolding nature of the artwork, its endless life as its virtual compossibilities are actualized," to slip into André Lepecky's Deleuzian vocabulary. Certainly, we want the dances to return, and we want new people to be haunted by them and to haunt them in turn. To quote Lepecky directly, "We welcome reenactments that actualize a work's imminent field of inventiveness and creativity." But this approach can implicitly rely upon a work's detachability from the contingencies that are part of what it is. I want to underscore, as Mark Franco has done, and I quote him from the Oxford Book of Dance and Reenactment, quote, the past work cannot simply reappear without the research work. And that danced reenactment asserts the non-correspondence of two times, two histories, two mentalities. I tried to suggest at the beginning that some dances even originally reenact themselves. This is the case of Extended Moment from Suite for Five. But I'm not sure that, and here I'm quoting Mark, the notion of historical time as chronicle time, that boring click, click, click of seconds passing needs to be, quote, destabilized by an uncertain historicity. At least I think it's a point worth debating, for I fear that by destabilizing the notion of the original, we end up with an infinitely renewable, a kind of vitalist trope, that in rejecting the authentic, we end up with the ceaseless generativity of the virtual, and that in championing multiple temporalities, belatedness and or untimeliness, we in fact forget time. Near the end of The Body is Archive, Lepecki quotes Sylvia Benso, a scholar of Levinas. She states, works of art, although humanly made, are self-sufficient. Their sufficiency erases the presence of the artist in them in order for the work to be released to its pure self-subsistence. In what way, I wonder, is self-sufficiency different from aesthetic autonomy? For me, the argument for promoting a limitlessly unfolding archive of reenactments, while compelling in some ways, is also problematic. It makes a Faustian pact, trading eternal life for human belonging. As Theodore Adorno writes in Aesthetic Theory, artworks, quote, have a life sui generis. Important artworks constantly divulge new layers. They age, grow old, go cold, and die. Now, Adorno very rarely has anything to say about reception, and as far as I can tell, he has nothing to say about dance reenactment. But even in this short quote, we can see the direction he might point us in. The sui generis life of the artwork is not just its self-sufficiency, the fact that it can constantly divulge new layers and thus live on in the bodies and stagings of others. The sui generis life of the work has a duration. It will age, grow cold, and die. Time is in the dance as historically embedded chronological tick-tock time. That is what Cunningham makes us see while obscuring the historical contingencies the archive may reveal. The Cunningham Trust wants his dances to be for all times, for all generations, to always speak to us, no matter who we are. And they do, but they also don't. I am not saying that Cunningham dances should no longer be staged or that dancers not trained by Cunningham shouldn't dance his choreography. I'm certainly not against reenactment or reconstruction for that matter. But there is a point where I begin to question what's really going on. In 2020, Patricia Lent launched Twist, Bend, Reach, Step, a Cunningham solo anyone can try. In a video, she breaks down a solo from 50 looks. You can try it from home, in your dining room. Twist, Bend, Reach, Step is, of course, far from the meditated reconstructions of Night of 100 Solos. And I'll show you a clip at the end of that if we have time. Still, I can't help asking whether in general the Trust's new stagings might be part of or belong to a different collection, a different Cunningham archive, one that is both continuous and discontinuous with the archive of an earlier period. Continuous because this new archive allows the work to live, and discontinuous because it allows the work to die. Okay, do we have time, Mark, for me to show a little bit of 4-3-3 from Night of 100 Solos?
Absolutely, Carrie, yeah, you do have time, so go ahead.
So let me tell you a little bit about what we're going to be seeing as I shift around. Let's see, I need to screen share again. There we go. Okay, so what you're going to see here is the end of a solo by Claude Johnson, dancing solo from Numbers, Angela Falk dancing a solo from Nearly 90, and Keith Sabato on a bicycle from Variations 5, and then you'll see all dancers do for 4 minutes and 33 seconds. This was the New York City production at BAM. Thank you. Okay. That's it.
Thank you. Thank you. That's your closing moment. I just want to confirm that you're done.
I'm done.
Thank you. Great. Well, thank you very much. I think we can look at a few comments because there are a number of them in the comment box. So I'll read to you a few things and we can move on from there. Is that okay? Okay, so Zita Allen actually has a few, she has three things she said, so maybe I'll just read them together, although they're separate. So I have an interview I recorded with Sevilla before she died, where she talked about that piece. Amazing to hear about it, so that's interesting. Next comment, right after that, I would be interested to know your impression of the overall impact of our view of dance if the African-American dancers are excluded. I don't know. And there's a third comment that might illuminate a little more this first question. I'm not sure. She also says, how much of the disconcerting gap, quote unquote, you refer to is the product of the Africanist presence in the Cunningham work, Night of 100 Solos? Does that, you want me to reread those or is that clear enough?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the questions. First of all, I would love to listen to that Sevilla Fort interview if you would be willing to share it with me. You can find my email online and maybe we could have an exchange. To address the disconcerting gap, no, what I was really thinking about was I was privileged to be able to observe one of the rehearsals for the LA production. Victoria Finlay's son, who lives in Southern California, allowed me to go with her to watch the rehearsal. And she was mounting a solo on a woman whose background was really in kind of Lisa Nelson's kind of improvisatory, very sense-based method. And this woman had an extremely difficult time taking on Merce's movement in the way that Victoria Finlayson, one of Merce's dancers, was trying to get her to take it on because she was channeling it through her own training, which was in such a different way of understanding movement. And the disconcerting gap I was referring to was the technical differences. The dancers on the stage were trained in very different techniques and a wide diversity of techniques, and they were diverse in their ages, in where they came from, and not just in terms of their race and ethnicity. So the disconcerting gap I was speaking about was really more about technique training.
Great, thank you. Mindy Aloff writes, could you rerun the clip of the duet fragment from the German film? It didn't seem as if the image we know from photos was held at all, but rather that the dancers moved very slowly through the image.
I can re-show it to if you want to see it again.
Oh, well.
Find it on my screen. Yeah, sure.
Maybe you could just address her comment at the moment.
I think it's pretty clear that they're holding the poses. They're, you know, especially it gets a little faster as it goes on at the beginning, the one where Carolyn is basically upside down with her leg in the air is held almost 3 seconds. So yeah, I could play it again if you want, if we have time.
I think, let's see, we have other questions and I think to debate that point and do it is maybe not appropriate right now. Ketu Ketrak writes, thanks, Carrie, for a fantastic talk. I wanted to ask you to elaborate on the notion of stillness, quote unquote, as used by Cunningham, and its relationship to temporality in the dance. Elaborate.
Thanks for coming. Beyond what I said, there's quite a bit of work on the notion of stillness. There's some fabulous work by Noemi Soleiman. There's Andre Lepecki's book on stillness and the resistance of stillness to dance as movement. Stillness is kind of a critical moment in dance's self-understanding. Of course, Merce Cunningham was doing this before he read Lepecki's book. But I think there is a criticality there. I think there is also a sensitivity to how he is learning to look at his own dance through the photographs that are being taken in his studio. When he first started out, he didn't have a professional photographer to work with. It was just friends. And Louis Stevenson was by no means a professional photographer, and his photographs are very flat if you compare them to something like Barbara Morgan, for instance. John Volpe, who worked for the Living Theater, when Cunningham and Volpe shared a studio together, when Cunningham and Living Theater shared a studio, but John Volpe would just come down and in exchange for Cunningham helping him move props, he would take photos of the company. So the first photos were very static, and I think Cunningham was interested in that. He was interested in how that looked. I don't think he theorized it, except that he was interested in technology's grasp of movement in general.
Oh. Great. That's such a great phrase, technology's grasp of movement. Okay. There's so much to think about here, but we'll continue to move through the questions and maybe we can come back to some of these things too. Susanna Filmer, thank you very much for your fascinating presentation. I'm intrigued by the idea of bringing the original back into the discussion and to, quote, allow the work to die, end quote. However, this still leaves us with the question of how we could identify the original in dance. Also, I'm wondering whether this would lead us again to the idea of authorship / the author subject. How would we have to reassess this position?
Yeah, I don't think there's a problem with creating friction. We have a phase of thinking that privileges the notion of originality and authenticity, and then we have a phase of criticism and theory that privileges notions of kind of an infinite regression or the an-original, kind of a post-Derridean reading. But I don't see a problem putting those two in friction. I'm not opposed to thinking about the authentic and the original as it is displaced and troubled by its deconstruction. I just don't want everything it allows us to think about to disappear.
Right. Yeah, this is such a delicate debate, actually. Because then I would just jump in here along with Susanna. When you talk about certain kind, I don't know what it all depends, of course, on what we're talking about when we talk about reenactments or reconstructions, because they all can be very interesting or very deadly. But going back to Lepecki's language about the compossibilities or the future possibilities of work that is past and even lost, it's hard for me to think of that as a vitalist trope. I mean, because it's not about exalting again in a kind of lost presence at all. I think it's about seeing the potentials, the unrealized potentials in certain actions that can be recovered actually through very rigorous means, not through sheer fantasy. So I think that, I don't know, I know it's a very hard thing to debate because one really has to look at very specific cases. But I think what Susanna is trying to say is that we remember certain things, and even if we dance them ourselves, of course, like as Carolyn Brown says, I worry, right, that we're losing. But that's what she experienced, and that's what's in her mind, but it's not actually really shareable. And I think that's Susanna's point, that and she's written interestingly on the unreliability of the witness also. Anyway, very, very delicate debate to have, but it's very interesting that it comes up here.
But the unshareable is super interesting. I agree with you completely that the notion of the compossible and going back and finding something virtually in the work that you can expand on, or you can use as a germ, or that is incredibly rich, and I'm not critiquing that as a process. I'm trying also, though, to mark the unshareables and the things that don't pass on, that don't move on, that die, that don't that serve as a kind of block, and that we do need to mourn.
Oh, okay. Okay, I want to think more about that. Linda Caruso-Haviland writes, but/and, what happens when those of us who have seen Merce or studied with Merce pass on? Who will know the difference between the work that lives, quote unquote, and the work that has died? Do we identify the archives differently? What do we learn from entering these different archives? And then in parentheses, my second question, that is, what do we learn, if relevant, is asking you to talk a bit more about an archive. The temporality of lectures left me a little behind. Does it have anything to do with your closing comments? I can read that again. What happens when those of us who have seen Merce or studied with Merce pass on? Who will know the difference between the work that lives and the work that has died? That's one question. Do we identify the archives differently in that case?
I love all those questions, and I want to spend time thinking about them. I think that I want to think about them in relation to a particular dance or particular choreographer, and not generalize, because of course, quite a bit of reenactment that's going on is of dances that none of us have seen, we couldn't have seen. They're from earlier centuries. Versus dances that are more contemporary and where care has been taken to archive them, et cetera. So there's so many there's so many distinctions we have to make about what it is we have to seize on and what it is we have to develop. but I guess I don't have such a big problem with the notion of an artwork passing, no longer being relevant, no longer being sustained.
It's kind of another, that could be another trope for, you know, the idea of disappearance, right? Peggy Phelan's idea that the
untold. I think that needs to be maintained in friction with, so I guess I'm having trouble getting to the post-ephemeral. I also want to make sure that I'm aware of the ephemerality as well as the durability.
Interesting. Lucia Ruprecht writes, thank you for this beautiful and thought-provoking talk, Carrie. I would like to come back to two points. Could you say more on the question of what theory of the artwork solicits an archival care? Which theory of the artwork, which wants you to identify what theory of the artwork solicits an archival care? And could you also explain a little more what you mean by affect is in the duration of Cunningham's intervallic poses/positions?
Yeah, great questions, Lucia. Oh God, I don't know if I can answer them well right off the bat. And those are the two questions. Those are, for me, the two places that if I were to do more writing, that's where I'd want to go. And the first one is the exact quote is that we edge with care toward the border of the archive. We edge with care toward the border of the archive. And my question was, what theory of the artwork solicits us to edge with care? In other words, I would say that it comes close to what Mark talks about in Epilogue for an Epilogue, or Epilogue of an Epilogue, where he talks about the need for research, the need for taking care of what's in the archive, and when we perhaps invent beyond it, for knowing where that is. It's a theory of the archive of the artwork that is privileging some kind of integrity to it. And that embedded within the distinction between the archive and the anarchive is this notion that the artwork, you do come to its edge. We have to care for that edge. As for your second question about the intervallic and how alpha, yeah, well, you know, look at the end of the clip that I showed you from 100 Solos. Think about the end when the camera is roving. I was trying to decide if I like the fact that the camera zooms in and roves, or if I don't like the fact that the camera zooms in and roves. Is it cheating? Because when you look at the 100 Solos and you're in the audience and you can't zoom in and out of people. I mean, you kind of can if you focus on them and you look really hard, but your actual angle of optic is not going to change. And I was just reading a Rilke poem, one of the Duino elegies yesterday, and he says that animals look in the open. Animals, and that was the kind of vision that Cunningham was trying to cultivate in us, is a looking that doesn't necessarily alight on and center on one person, but is able to take in the whole field. And the camera's kind of choosing for us what to focus in on. And I think one of the things that happens when you don't have a camera telling you what to look at, and you have to take in the visual array, and you have to decide how your eyes are going to move across the scene, is you become overwhelmingly aware of the affect those choices, that duration in which you are making those choices, that affect it produces, that is actually the passage of time without the intervention of focalizing lenses, that creates in you some kind of emotional response.
Mm-hmm. Right. I have a question from Judith Rodenbeck. Too far afield, she says, this may be too far afield, but it strikes me that Cunningham, on your reading, is producing a theory or quasi-theory of photography. It's alongside Barthes, but not quite Barthesian, and certainly not about any quote-unquote decisive moment, end quote. There's something more like Susan Sontag's Every Sunset, quote-unquote, difference in repetition. And then the chronotopy of observation, what is seen in the photograph or the archive, exclamation point, at different moments.
That's wonderful. Well, that might be a way that the work can live also is, you know, those different moments that we observe it.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think it brings us back a little to when you evoke double consciousness. I mean, you didn't say double consciousness, but you evoked something like the Du Boisian double consciousness occurring in the memories of the performers themselves, of the African-American performers, if I'm remembering correctly. And the you spoke of, I'm kind of almost quoting here, dialectical understanding of how art and history evolve. Mm-hmm. Maybe you could speak a little more to that, because I think that this whole tension, or as you say, yeah, tension between the idea of an original and a reenactment is somehow in that double consciousness too, a certain level.
Yeah, I have to think about that. Can you write that down so I can think about it again? I don't think I can think about everything now. That's really good. That's really interesting to me. Double consciousness.
In other words, the original itself is always the product of a double consciousness as well.
I have to think about that.
Yeah. Well, anyway, yeah.
Seeing yourself as you're seen, and feeling yourself as you are, because that's what double consciousness means to me.
Yeah, sure, that's a good definition.
I've lost track of what the question was about.
My question.
What I wanted to do, the reason, and I really deviated. I wanted to do a lot of things and probably too much, but I really did want to honor the very refined, sensitive response of these Black dancers to their experience, and their desire not to either condemn Cunningham or engage in hero worship of him. And I think that they are trying to teach that to their students also, that too frequently I find that students in my classroom want to cancel an author or an artist because that author or artist makes a racist remark or has a, you know, kind of antiquated opinion of women or whatever it might be, and not being able to take into account the way in which the time period impinges on the art's own ability to transcend mm-hmm. itself or to transcend the artist's own limitations, that is how art is in history. And if we were going to go through the record and only choose those artists who agree with what we agree with now or think the way we think now, I think we're misunderstanding art's embeddedness in time.
Yeah, nice. Justin Tourneau writes, coming back to the calm possible, what do you think Merce's take might be in reenacting a process of making the work instead of reenacting a product? I'm thinking about events, for instance.
That's a great question. I would not dare to say what I think Cunningham would think about something. I don't want to put myself in that position. But I'd love the idea of reenacting the process of making the work. I think that is something Cunningham did again and again when he taught workshops. And I have a chapter in my book, the last chapter is about his workshops. And that is essentially what he did, was he gave the students exercises that mirrored his own process so that they would reenact the process of making works. I don't see events so much as that, but I guess structurally they are, yeah.
Great. Arlie Epton writes, perhaps the debate about the original versus the restagings has to do with a sense of preciousness about the original, especially felt by someone who learned directly from Merce Cunningham. One can understand the sense of loss borne by a viewer who was able to experience the direct learning. That's where it stops. So maybe it's more of a comment than a question. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think I've spent too much time with these people, so I kind of identify with their mourning.
One can get quite absorbed in mourning. I know. Yeah, it's a little dangerous too, right? There's always nostalgia around the original as well, but it doesn't mean, yeah, but then this, yeah, okay. It's such a delicate and interesting area to explore. But Sassi Del Bono says, I found interesting your question as to whether the choreographic notes in the archive belong to the dance, and therefore the archive as a place maybe preserving something other than the dances. Is there something more to say on that?
I would love to see a reenactment based on the marginal comments in his. I would love it. Or on, for instance, the what was on the back. Because he didn't, I mean, yeah, he used notebooks, but he also used whatever was available in his home. And often that was the stuff that Cage had thrown away. So I would love to see a reenactment that thought about the support, I mean, the actual physical support and what else was scribbled on it. The complexity, you know, he has notes that were written in Russian because he was teaching himself Russian early on when he was doing Antic Meat, for instance. A lot of it is in Russian, a lot of French. I think that's an interesting part of these contingencies, these kind of marginal, I want to say textures that could, they are compossibles too. They are generative too. And that would be how I would go about reenacting.
I think the reenactment, Paul Kaiser did a wonderful film of Merce. He filmed him doing loops, his final solo, filmed his hand, but he did it with movement sensors. So it wasn't an actual film. It was really like you saw the energy vectors. And then he put over that Merce's reading of his diary when he first came to New York, 1937. And me, so a final solo and a first arrival, and the two were superimposed. And to me, that something emerges there, and again, it's not strictly speaking a reenactment, but the most interesting reenactments I see are where nothing is actually, strictly speaking, replicated, but precisely because there is no replication, something is allowed to emerge. And I'm not quite sure what the nature of that something is. I don't think I understand that yet. But it's something that actually no one can say that that's the original or that, but it is something, and I'm not even saying it's futurity either. I would say from my own experience, something emerges which is a very materially conceptual presence. I had the same sensation when I saw the Worcester Group's Poor Theater, and they completely simulated in Polish a scene from Apocalypse of Grotowski. And because it was so obviously simulated, I felt I was in the presence of the original, because I saw the original in the late 60s. So I was there. So precisely because nothing was being simulated, I was allowed to return to that. And I think that's something of the magic of what draws me to the notion of reenactment. Anyway, I just thought I'd throw that in. Alexander H. Schwann, we have a few more minutes and we have more questions. Very, very rich and generative talk, Carrie. Thank you so much. Alexander says, how would you conceptualize the archive in a particularly queer perspective without the subtext of generative storing and reproductivity? How would this apply to Cunningham?
I kind of want you to answer that question.
Can you type your answer, please, immediately?
I get the, I mean, the no future business is, I guess I'm kind of attracted to that. I guess there's a, yeah, then the, I mean, but reenactment is not reproducibility. So it's a very different proposition. There may be something queer in reenactments in general, you know, but that's stretching the term queer to mean non-self-identical or resisting identity or resisting reproduction, or that's it. Has Alexander typed more?
Not yet, but we'll give him another minute. Alexander, we're waiting for your answer. Lucia, by the way, writes in the chat, thank you for your brilliant answer, Carrie. I had exactly the same questions about camera movement in mind when watching your clip. So I don't know if we have, if Alexander is following through on that or not, but obviously it's something we can continue with in the future. I have another, Susan Rosenberg writes, does the study of how different choreographers bring past repertory back, reconstruct it, quote unquote, give us insight into these questions? Well,
does that... I mean, yes. Oh, did you say how different choreographers bring their own works back?
I guess what's being referred to here possibly is revival, what is sometimes called revival rather than reconstruction. In other words, yes, how people who actually generated the work return to it. I mean, I'm guessing because I don't know, but that's what it sounds like to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wish I were more knowledgeable about that.
Alexander writes another comment. Yes, no future, death drive, this dimension.
And what Cunningham would think about that. I think that was very much, you know, everything I read, I didn't have a chance to ask him, but the people who did have a chance to ask him and observed him said that he had very little interest in reviving his own works. And that death drive is also generative, that the death drive is itself what causes you to leave things behind, to let them grow cold, to let them be shelved. And that itself is what allows you to start all over again with a new idea. I found it moving that more than once, he jotted notes to himself that express a deep anxiety about not having any more ideas. Mm-hmm. And I saw him reaching back to former preoccupations in order to do them differently. Mm-hmm. And expressing angst at that moment because he knew he was going back to go forward.
Right, so interesting. And possibly the fascination with the photograph, with the dance, you know, is a way, as you say, to inhabit, re-inhabit time also.
Hmm. As you said, two things. I mean, it's that, and it's also just a curiosity about how you can see through things differently through a lens. What you can see, he talks a lot about that when he started working with life forms, is how all of a sudden he could see things that he couldn't see before. And so there's that too, there's technology as a way of having ideas.
Yes, and your book also explores that so beautifully, because your use of the term relationality, you know, the way you introduce his main preoccupation in being with relationality and therefore in some sense with the theatrical as you use it in the book, I think is such an amazing rewriting of the usual view of Cunningham as, again, arbitrary in the sense, you know, in the sense of purely chance and purely arbitrary, that it opens up a whole different way. And this is another offshoot of that, I believe, of that.
The question, yeah, that's double consciousness too, in a certain way. Theatricality is double consciousness.
Yeah. But when you said, when you defined it, it seemed to me that that was precisely the theatrical experience itself.
And yet I want to preserve it for a particularly racialized experience.
Sure.
I want to make sure that we don't take Du Bois and we make him, we can have him talk about something else, but I don't want to lose that he was talking about a racialized or an experience of racialization.
Sure he is, absolutely.
That's what I'm, there was an original meaning, just to be polemical again.
Yeah, but the term double consciousness is used a lot in criticism without always thinking of Du Bois necessarily.
But yeah, yeah, that I guess I want to.
No, I totally agree and understand. Well, perhaps we should just say no to future, yes to the death drive. And no, actually, this will be recorded, so we can revisit it. Well, Carrie, the time is about up, and I want to thank you so much. This was just an amazing talk, and I think the discussion was very rich, too. So thank you, and I know it's going to continue. This is not over. So thank you, and thanks to all who contributed and were here today.